Today is a big day. We will be doing our first HTTP request, which means that we will be, for the first time, getting data from a remote location, from a server. So at the beginning, our data, which is at this point just a list of messages, so firstly, it was inside the application as a data structure, as a list of maps. Then we move it to a file to somehow simulate the process of getting the data into our application and the need for serialization. So transforming this a string into data structures in our application. And now we are going a step further. We are moving it to a remote location. And this is usually the most common way of developing applications, because usually data is outside of your application and you need to somehow fetch it. So in order to get the data from a server, there are different ways, but we will be using a protocol called HTTP. So protocol is another fancy name for, it's a set of guidelines that people agree on in order to communicate. Knowing this set of guidelines, you are able to, you know the rules, you know the methods that are needed to interact with the server. At the same time, people who provide data know that they are people who will be able to get this data, because the rules of communication, of interactions are known. And this is a protocol. So as I said, there are different protocols and different ways of sending and exchanging data between, let's say, entities on the internet. But the most common way is HTTP. And HTTP, there are different ways of interacting with data. For example, you can request data to be sent to you, or you can send data yourself to someone, to a server. So we say that they are different operations, and we call them methods. HTTP methods. For example, if you are typing google.com or microsoft.com or any other address in your browser, you are doing a get HTTP request. There's a method called get. And as the name suggests, it's a method for getting the data. So in this case, you're getting a string, which is HTML, and your browser knows how to display it, because it describes different parts of your of a website. But there are other methods. For example, you can send something to someone, to a server. For example, if there is a form on a website and you fill the form and then you click the send button, you are doing a post request, another method. So there is more methods like that. For example, to update or to check if you can do a request. But today we would be just using a get, because we will move our list of messages to a server to simulate this process. First of all, let's create this server. And in order to do that, I will be using a website called Moki. I just found it. And this website allows you to create so-called mocks for your requests, which means that you can return a predefined set of data for a request. So it's just a kind of like cheating. This simplifies a little bit the process, because usually if you're doing a request to a server, there is some kind of a process which listens and interprets your request, and then maybe do a query to your database to fetch your data you requested, and then send it to you. We won't be dealing with that at this point. So the only thing we want to simulate is the process of sending a request and receiving a response. So we will just predefine our response. So the response will be always the same. And I will just go back to the application. I will open our JSON file. I will copy the whole file and I will paste it here in the body. So this form says that whenever someone requests something from this service, it will always get this string, which is a JSON file. So I click generate my HTTP response, and now I have a link. So let's first check if it works. So I will paste it into my browser. And as you can see, it returns the string, the same as the file. But it's now located somewhere else, somewhere in the internet. I don't manage the server. Now we are ready to fetch this data through our application. So let's go back to code. And instead of requesting now the data from a file, we need to remove that. And we need to perform this operation of getting data as we did in the browser. In order to do that, we need a function which will go to a server, do the request, and return the string. And this is a quite complicated process, and usually we don't do it by hand. They are libraries that do this for us. To resolve this problem, let's go to a website called Flutter Packages, which is located at dartlang.org. And here we can search for existing libraries that other people created. And let's just type HTTP. I hit enter. And here there's a pretty nice thing in this package library. You have a score which signifies if this library is being updated, if it's well written, and so on. So the first result is a library called just HTTP. Let's click on it. And we can see that the author is the team, the Dart team. So that's a good sign. And usually if you're looking for libraries, you should give a preference to libraries being developed by people who developed the language. So this is the HTTP library. They give you some kind of short snippets on how to use it. In this case, they are showing how to use a method for posting data. So sending data to the server. And we are rather interested in getting the data. So let's click on installing. So they describe how to install this package. We need to add HTTP. So I'll go back to the code. I will open our pubspec file. And in dependencies, I will add this package. Okay, it's done. And now I can use it. So as I removed the load string function, this package is no longer used. So it's marked as not being used. We can remove that. And now we need to import our HTTP package. So whenever you are importing a package, you are importing all the names that are defined in that package. So sometimes names can clash because the same name can be used for different things. For this reason, I'm prefixing this import with HTTP. So this will be a prefix we'll be using to access the names defined inside this package. So now I can do HTTP GET, and I can just paste this URL that we generated here. This request. So let's before we write it, if I hover over GET, I see that this is a method which returns future response. So future is just a way to say that the value eventually will arrive. So as we discussed in one of the previous episodes, I was telling you this analogy that reading something from memory is like a few seconds for your computer compared to reading from a file, which is like weeks. So it's a long operation. So future means that this will eventually arrive to you, but the result is response. So we will just write it, and we need to await it because these are weeks. Okay, so we are getting the response, and now if I type response dot, I can see different methods and fields defined inside this class. So I don't need to go inside by clicking the command as we did before. I can just press dot and I can see what's defined, what's available publicly. So when I press arrows, I can see what's the type of this of the thing being returned and the description. I can, for example, request headers. I can request different things. But what's important for me at this point is just the body of this request, which is a string, which represents this part. So when you let's read again the description of body, the body of the response as a string, right? So this is what we need. And we just need to assign it to the content we had before. And that's pretty much it. That's what we need to do. This way, the content is still the same as before, but this time we are getting it from a remote location. So if I refresh the application, it should work as before. Yeah, and it's working. Again, we haven't changed a lot in our application. It's still just a list of messages. But this time we are getting it from a remote location, which is like pretty common way of developing applications. A few ideas before we finish it off. First of all, as I said, HTTP has many different methods. So if you go to Mozilla documentation, you can learn about all the possible methods that exist and about any other aspect of the HTTP protocol. So here is it describes the GET method, which we used, the other methods like POST, sending data, updating, deleting resources, and so on. Another thing, here we used an import and we requested that every name in that package is prefixed with HTTP. And there are some conventions when you write the code like that. So you may wonder why I haven't written it like that or any other way. So if you are in doubt, you can always go to the docs. And there is a section in Dart lang called Effective Dart Style. There's an article which describes how you should name things, which conventions you should use. And if we search for an import here, it says that every import, if we are using as something, should be lowercase and with underscores. So it shouldn't start with a big letter. It shouldn't use this casing, or it shouldn't be written in all caps. Okay, so before we go, I will just change this declaration here. I will be more specific, I will provide more intent. And that's pretty much it. So we did our first HTTP request. We are fetching now the data from a remote location, from a server. And now our application resembles more and more to a real application. So see you in the next episode.